knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
For the next few tutorials, we will be focusing on settled agricultural civilizations. This isn't because hunter-gatherers aren't important or interesting, but they leave much less in terms of archaeological remains. Keep in mind that they were present throughout history and are still present today. The importance of the birth of civilization to our modern world cannot be overstated. It was through these civilizations around the world that fields like math and science flourished. Our current globalized world is built on these concepts. As discussed in the previous tutorial, human civilization seems to have begun independently in five areas. When intensive agriculture as a subsistence strategy spread to peoples around them, civilizations began radiating out of these initial cradles of civilization. All of these first civilizations and the civilizations after them were very different, each with unique histories, cultural practices, architecture, and agricultural techniques. Therefore, we can't possibly hope to highlight each civilization in any detail in this series. For example, we could devote an entire course to Egyptology, the study of the ancient Egyptian civilization, and much of this information is indeed covered over in the World History series. However, for our purposes here, let's take a look at the broad development of civilization, from its birth to where we are today. The productive ecosystems of the Fertile Crescent led to the development of two major civilizations based around the Tigris and Euphrates in Mesopotamia and the Nile River in Egypt. Cities first appeared in the Fertile Crescent as early as 8000 BP at archaeological sites like Jericho or Çatalhöyük. However, these aren't typically referred to as civilizations because they lack some of the other qualifications. The first people that are widely accepted to exhibit all the qualifications discussed for civilization were the Sumerians of Mesopotamia, coming clearly into the archaeological record around 6000 BP. Cities show a high degree of social complexity, such as clear signs of administrative and bureaucratic centers. This high level of political complexity is often called a state. The Sumerians were also the first to widely use symbols to represent ideas useful to the state, such as tax records, land holdings, and political decisions. This was called cuneiform, one of the earliest writing systems developed by humanity. Because of this, mathematics were first able to be recorded and discussed, and many of the early mathematical principles were standardized by the Sumerians. This was born out of necessity, so the Sumerians could carry out trade and taxation on a scale not yet seen by the world. They also had a love of astronomy and recorded and studied the five planets visible to the naked eye. They even drew shapes out of the stars they observed, called constellations. The humanities also were greatly expanded, with the first stories being recorded in the written word, like the Epic of Gilgamesh. Not long after the beginning of civilization in Mesopotamia, the Nile River Valley of the Fertile Crescent gave rise to another civilization, ancient Egypt. Beginning around 5000 BP, the ancient Egyptians are famous for their pyramids and distinct writing style, hieroglyphics. These civilizations grew and developed, and other nearby groups, such as the Minoans of Crete and later the Mycenaeans of Greece, began state building. As these civilizations developed, so did a new discovery, metalworking. Bronze was the first metal widely used in tool and weapon production. The acquisition of copper and tin used to make bronze began the first widespread trade system across Europe, Africa, and Western Asia. This is called the Bronze Age. However, this interdependent system was not to last. Around 1200 BCE, the system crumbled in an event called the Bronze Age Collapse. This saw the shrinking and collapse of many civilizations in this region. However, civilization would return, especially through the Phoenicians who built several cities around the Mediterranean Sea. After this collapse, iron was beginning to be used more than bronze, as it is stronger and more common. This is called the Iron Age. One city in particular, Rome, quickly grew into a powerful state. By 300 BCE, the Italian peninsula was under the control of Rome. Continuing its conquest, Rome controlled much of the regions surrounding the Mediterranean and much of Europe by 300 CE. It was also during this time that Christianity began being practiced in the Middle East. It spread quickly, and in the year 380, it was adopted by the Roman Empire. However, Rome wasn't to last either. In the year 476, the western part of the Roman Empire dissolved, becoming several Christian kingdoms. The eastern part of the Roman Empire became the Byzantine Empire. This marks the beginning of the medieval period. By this time, writing is fairly commonplace throughout these civilizations. Therefore, the study of this period and the periods after it are more commonly studied by historians rather than archaeologists. Even so, medieval and historic archaeologists still exist and provide important context for historians. The medieval period was characterized by the dominance of Christianity across Europe. Another Abrahamic religion, Islam, was founded in 670. It spread quickly throughout Asia and Africa. By the late medieval period, cities and civilizations existed all throughout Europe, Asia, and Africa. Some examples of medieval European civilizations would be the Byzantines, England, and the Holy Roman Empire. Examples of Middle Eastern civilizations would be the Umayyad and Abbasid caliphates. African civilizations would include the Mali Empire, the Kingdom of Zimbabwe, and the Swahili coast city-states. At the beginning of the 14th century, the interaction of these civilizations, such as the spreading of scientific discoveries from Islamic caliphates to Europe, a new era began, called the Renaissance. This marked an era of remarkable discovery in science, mathematics, and the humanities. We just flew through a lot of human history very quickly, skipping a lot of events and greatly simplifying many concepts. However, the study of this great story of humanity and the different peoples that took part in it all fall under archaeology. This exemplifies how broad the field is, yet all archaeologists use the methodology we discussed earlier in the series to discover more about the past. Once again, if you wish to learn about any of these time periods in more detail, be sure to visit the World History series. But for now, let's continue with archaeology by looking at the development of the other two cradles of civilization in the Old World.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.